Hello, welcome back to another video on astrology. In this video, we are back in conversation with Dr. Y.V. Subbarao. As you all know, we have completed series one and then this is series two. And we have already done two episodes. In case you have not seen them, please remember to watch them because it has some kind of correlationship with the next episodes. And today we have two topics. The first one is significance of Patri lineage, and that's going to be part five because in each episode we have done two parts, and therefore this is part five. And signification of viewing Vasishta, his wife Arundhati, and Dhruva stars in a post-marriage ritual. So we are going to learn a lot, as usual, from Dr. Y.V. Subbarao, who is more than eager to share his knowledge with all of us. So welcome, Dr. Y.V. Subbarao.
Thank you, sir. At the very outset, I would like to answer about a few questions which the viewers have put to me. I'll read the question and then answer. One person has already asked, could you all please clarify if we are supposed to celebrate Sankranti at the beginning of Uttarayana on December 23rd, or is it right to celebrate it as Makar Sankranti, as we are doing now? Sankramana of the sun into any Rasi of the 12 Rasis of the Zodiac is named after that particular Rasi, like Mesha Sankramana, Vrishabha Sankramana, like that. But Makar Sankramana has got a significance. In that, it is exactly coming 180 degrees opposite Cancer. Leo and Cancer are treated as one unit, we have been telling right from the beginning. And these two signs, Leo and Cancer, are owned by Sun and Moon. So exactly opposite to 180 degrees, the two signs owned by Saturn, it starts with Capricorn first and then Aquarius later. But entering into Capricorn, that is 180 degrees to Cancer, is really significant. So Makara Sankramana is significant because the entire zodiac is divided into two parts. That is summer solstice and winter solstice. So the summer solstice begins with Cancer and winter solstice begins with Capricorn. And winter solstice always starts in December, either on 28th or 21st or 22nd or 23rd as the case may be. But it is permanent. It is a cardinal point in astronomical year. And therefore, Makara Sankramana, the moment the sun entered into Makara, we have to celebrate it. Not 3 weeks after, as noted in the Panchanga, the almanac. Nearly no good will accrue to us taking a holy dip 3 weeks after its actual occurrence. And the sun cannot wait for the almanac to come into line. Therefore, it is always admissible to have a bath, holy bath, on December whenever the sun enters into that. And if they also want to continue, they can, according to almanac, have a second time a bath. Doesn't matter. So the next question is, what is your take on palmistry, numerology, etc.? According to you, the lines in our palm has anything to do with our fate and astrology? I do not have any knowledge about the palmistry, but I find in numerology more prevalent also in astrology. It comes in agreement of the house significations of both Dasha and Bhuktinatha, even Antarnatha also. I have verified this for a very long time, and I got there was an occasion when I was to actually take a small coupon from a jeweler's shop. So it incidentally happened that I then immediately recollected my Dasha and Bhukti at that time. I entered into a Bhukti just a couple of days back. So immediately I asked him to give me a coupon in any series carrying 2 and 4, 24. And 42. So I was given that, and within 3 days the lottery was there, and I won 2,400 rupees worth of jewelry.
Very good.
Immediately, sir, within 2 days' time. So the numerology is very much there in the agreement of the house ownerships of both the Dasha and Bukti lords. Are you talking about the 108 division? They asked me when I said about the mysterious number 60 and 108. And the 60 and 108 are the numbers of which I said, but it has nothing to do with the D108. D108 division value will be only 16 minutes angle, 1-6. 1-6 minutes angle means 0.25 minutes time delay in the birth time will naturally shift to D108 by one division. So it is not advisable to go into such a high sensitivity when we are not sure about our own watches and no two watches agree. Then another question is, what is the significance of the natural fourth lord and ninth lord that are representative of mother and father are in Shashashtaka relationship in the Kalapurusha or natural zodiac? Eagerly wanting to know this reason. As I have already said, Leo and Cancer are owned by Sun and Moon. Sun is known as Pitrukaraka and Moon is Matrukaraka. They go together as a unit. And ninth house signifying father is in the sense that ninth house signifies father, preceptor and guru. Father is considered to be the first teacher before we are put into a small school at the fifth year. So after the fifth year, it is the father who teaches us. In that sense, it is the ninth house. But actually speaking, Pitrukaraka and Matrukaraka significations are more important than considering fourth and ninth houses as Shashashtaka. So the significations have been given more importance in actually doing so. The last one is, the human being is born after 4 lakh times passing all stages. Are we going to be born as human beings only for in future? So it all depends on the type of karma that one actually does. If he does something, karma of the order of human nature, he will naturally be guaranteed of his human birth. If it is more heinous and a devilish one, naturally he can expect to go back, not even as a devil, but only even as a mosquito or something. That's what Adi Shankara, the great saint of Advaita philosophy, has said, who has tossed his soul from one body to another. So that's the end of the question part of it. I hope I have answered it to the satisfaction of the viewers.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir.
So now we shall take up the parts 1 and part 2 of the third episode, part 6 and for part 5 and 6.
Correct.
Fifth part of the third episode is pattern lineage significance. What is meant by pattern lineage? It is nothing but gotra. What is gotra then? We are all considered to be the descendants of great saints, the Saptarishis. There are not only seven rishis, Saptarishis, but there are a number of rishis who are called as Saptarishis because it's called a designation. Because Brahma is a designation, Indra is a designation, Saptarishis are a designation. So every time the Saptarishis go on changing. So at one point of time or the other, they have acted as Saptarishis. So there are in all four lists and four Saptarishis, that is the groups. So 28 people we have, and we are all considered to be the descendants of one of these rishis. So our gotra, the pattern lineage, goes after the name of that particular rishi. For instance, Vasistha means Vasistha Gotram. If we are descendants of Bharadvaja, Bharadvaja Gotram, Angirasa, Angirasa Gotram, Kashyapa, Kashyapa Gotram, like that. So it is the male descendant. That means we have seen in the last videos that Y chromosome and X chromosome, these things are available as X chromosomes in both males and females. X chromosome is double X in females and XY in males. This Y chromosome is continued from this in this gotra system. So it is grandfather, son and grandson. It goes on like that. women do not get any gotra because they have no Y chromosome. But the descendants of a particular rishi are considered to be siblings. Therefore, marriages within the same gotra are prohibited. That is what is called a sagotra is prohibited. It is there from Vedic ages, that is from Rig Veda. And Manusmriti and other scriptures also prohibit sagotra marriages, that is marriage within the blood relatives. So it is not in genetics and medicine in modern this one. This is there in the age-old tradition of our religion and also in Vedic scriptures. It has got a scientific reason. The next one is, after this, the fifth part is completed, we will go in for sixth part. That is the significance of viewing Saptarshi Mandalam and Dhruva. In the Saptarshi Mandalam, Arundhati and Vasishtha are part of it. So Dhruva also is there in another mandalam. That has got nothing to do with Saptarshi Mandalam, but it has a connection. Therefore, we shall discuss with that. And more than that, one may ask me, what is the actual relationship of astrology in this? The relationship of astrology to astronomy and also philosophy is here. The seventh house signifies marriage. And the estimation of a marriage and its rough time of occurrence or celebration of marriage in a native's life will be measured in terms of Jupiter's revolution. Whether the marriage takes place in the first revolution of 12 years or in the second revolution of 12 years or the third revolution of 12 years, because after third revolution, it means it has no meaning. Anyway, we shall see whether Jupiter with its revolutions has got any bearing on getting the marriage quickly confirmed. So in the native, what we see is, we have already completed in the first episode the birth of a child. He has grown to a school-going boy. And in the second episode, we have covered up the adolescent age of 12 years to 24 years. He has become a full-fledged man, well-educated and employed also. He is now, negotiations are being made in the family for marrying, getting the boy married. He is 24 years, two revolutions of Jupiter are over. In this, the third revolution, the fourth revolution, and the fifth revolution of Jupiter, that is starting from 24th year to 60th year, we are going to deal here. So now I shall switch over to this PowerPoint presentation. This is part 5, episode 3, significance of patrilineage in marriages. So as has been usual, I am showing this. The stages in life of a human being who have completed this child birth and the second one from adolescent age to school going boy up to this point, 12 years to 24 years, and the third stage, fourth, and stage 4 and stage 5, there are three revolutions of Jupiter from 24 to 60. So at 24th year, he is educated, employed, and now negotiations are being carried on in the house to get him married. Whether it's a girl or boy, the marriage negotiations will have to be made. So the search for a suitable boy for the girl or a girl for the boy in their respective families, the first and prime consideration is the gotra, that is the patrilineage. Whether they belong to the same patrilineage, if so, they are considered siblings. And so the prime consideration is to completely go out of sagotra marriages and going for marriages of a boy or girl in a different gotra, not the same gotra of the boy or the girl. So in that sense, we have got, I told you about the Saptarishis, and we are all considered to be the descendants of them. And these Saptarishis have got a great bearing on this Ursa Major. This is in the Northern Constellation. This is in astronomy, the seven stars. But it has life in our religion. It is considered to be the souls of the seven great rishis. And this is in the form of a big, this is also called a big bear or a Big Dipper. And this is the dip, actually. And the Big Bear is this particular Ursa Major, together with some other neighboring stars, will naturally give a figure of the Big Bear. I have shown it here in the corner. So these seven rishis here, shown here, and the eighth one here is Alkar, you find. This is kept at a distance because it is not part of the Saptarishis, but it is extra as a rishi called, joined with the Saptarishis later on. So these Saptarishis are actually named by the sun, by the seven stars. So we have got Alkaid Bhrigu, Mazar Vasishta, and Alkar Arundhati, Aliyat Angirsa, and Magras is Atri, Fagda is Pulasta, and Merak is Pulaha, and Dube is Kratu. These are all the seven stars here, and they are the represented by the seven great rishis called the Saptarishis, and in that we find Alkar is Arundhati, though she was not originally a member of the Saptarishis. She is the wife of the consort of Vasishta, and she has earned such a great name that Saptarishis have accepted her to be in their union. So this is Alkar, the small star near Mizar. Mizar and Alkar are the two combined one. One is Vasishta and the other is small one is Alkar. They are wife and husband. So these are the seven rishis, the names of which will be known or already known. And there are other three lists of Saptarishis. We will come to know of it soon. And we are all descendants of all these 20 to 28 rishis. And so we are known as the belonging to that particular gotra. So marriages in blood relatives, as I told you already, is prohibited completely from Sagotra because they are considered to be siblings born to the same descendant. Because it is of scientific value to avoid marriages in the Sagotra for genetic considerations. And Manusmriti clearly states that blood relationships marriages on the mother's side is completely prohibited for seven generations. So one can understand how much of importance is there for the genetic importance in actually prohibiting it for seven generations from the mother's side. The other one is Ayurveda states that the gotra marriages, same gotra marriages from a father's side is going to cause great genetic problems and gestational problems in the fetus itself. And the mother's side, the problems would be after the birth of the child, which is horrible. On the father's side, the problems on the genetic side will be in the foetus. So if the one doesn't want to get on with the foetus, one can even terminate it. But with the mother's side relations, the child born will have serious repercussions for generations, for seven generations. Then the last one is, so when two blood relatives get married, the chromosomes are identical. And any damage in the chromosomes of one person is also there in the other. And these two will naturally double up and finally give rise to serious simple repercussions. So in the beginning I told that the father, the male member will have XY chromosomes in the sex and the mother will have XX chromosomes. Here there is a similar pair. So if there is damage in one X, there is another X in the pair to repair. But here, this is a dissimilar repair, X at Y. If Y is damaged, there is no repairing at all. There is no another one in the pair. So X from the male member can combine with either of the X from the female member and still give rise to this X with X, give rise to female child, and this X again with this X, the second X of mother will give rise to female child. So there will be possibilities of the X of the father combining with any X of the two X's of the mother and give rise to two types of daughters. And Y also can combine with the X of the mother and give rise to one child. Similarly, the Y of the father can combine to with another X and give rise to, we can see here, the X of father combines with the X of mother gives rise to one girl child. Similarly, the same X of father combines with another X of the mother gives rise to female child. And here the Y chromosome combines with one X of the mother, X and Y, this will give rise to boy. Similarly, the another Y from combining with another X gives rise to boy. So XX will always give female children and XY will always give male children. So there are totally four types of children that can be had from the father and the mother. Here, this is about the chromosomes of blood relatives. Just as I said, the chromosomes are identical in both males and females, except the sex chromosome, which is XX in females and XY in males. So if these two are married, belong to the same gotra, the chromosomes, autosomes are identical. If these autosomes, any of the autosome is damaged, that is also repeated here. And therefore, by getting married, the defect becomes doubly multiplied. So this is all about the gotra, and now we shall consider the significance of viewing Dhruva, Brahmarshi, Vasishtha and his wife Arundhati in a post-marriage ritual. So after getting the boy or the girl married out of the same gotra, they are safe regarding the children, and now we will consider the significance of viewing in the post-marriage ritual. Dhruva is a legend whom we know. We have already talked about the Saptarishis, but Dhruva is totally different, away from it. But it has got a connection in a way. It is still higher than the Saptarishi Loka. Dhruva is at a higher plane. So, Dhruva is worshipped as a boy. He has worshipped Srimanarayana, the Lord, and asked him, because he was refused a seat on his father's lap, he went into the forest, he resigned to the forest, and then made meditation. He made penance, and Srimanarayana was very much pleased with him, and then granted him the boon. The child wanted nothing else except moksha. The Lord said that after ruling his kingdom for 26,000 years, he will be brought back to a seat that is permanent and stable, which no one can have it and had so far. So this 26,000 years that the Lord has promised to Dhruva has an astronomical meaning. We know the precession of equinoxes at the rate of 1 degree for every 72 years. That means for 360 degrees, it comes to 25,920 years exactly, but it is approximately 26,000 years. So this was got a bearing on 26,000 years as the precession of the whole circle of the celestial sphere. Unless it seems, it occurs to me that when Dhruva was actually assured, asked for the boon, the Lord himself had already placed some other person, some other star at that point, and Dhruva cannot find the place vacant. Therefore, he had to wait for 26,000 years to be placed there. So, just I told you about the star is already occupied. So, perhaps in 14,000 years, 12,000 years before Dhruva came into being, as the North Star, there was Vega, another star that was occupying that, perhaps where the Lord promised him. So after 12,000 years, 26,000 years, Polaris, that is Dhruva, could be placed at this point to indicate the true North. So this is the Earth, and this is the actual axis at one time, Earth's axis today, and to Polaris North Star, Polaris is exactly at the end of this arrow. And after another 12,000 years, because it's already 14,000 years over, and after another 12,000 years over, after another 14,000 years, this axis will move in this direction, dotted one, and it will point to Vega. So the true north will be Vega after 14,000 years. And after 26,000 years, again, it will come back to Polaris. So Polaris and Vega will alternate as the pole stars. Previously, I said about the Saptarishis. There are four sets of Saptarishis according to the four texts. The texts are Mahabharata texts, ancient Hindu astronomy, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and Krishna Yajurveda. In all these things, we find seven in each set. So these are all different, except Atri and Bhruvu, who are constant. And Atri is there, common in all the four sets. And Vasistha is another one, who is also found in all the four sets. These two are considered to be the greatest amongst the Maharshis, Saptarishis. That's why they are called Brahmarshi. So Atri and Vasistha are Brahmarshis, and so they are found always in all the four sets. So 4 2 8 are over 20 extra are there, 20 new Saptarishis, and these two, in all 22 Saptarishis, and there are 22 main Gotras, and we are all the descendants of one of these 22 Rishis, and we are all considered siblings of a particular Rishi. Here, the Saptarishi Mandalam, the Asa major of what we have seen in the first slide, I am showing it here, the Saptarishi Mandalam here, with the names of the stars as also their corresponding rishis here. This is Saptarishi Mandalam. In the Vishnu Purana, it is said that after Bhuloka, there is Nakshatra Mandalam. After Nakshatra Mandalam, there is Saptarishi Mandalam. And above Saptarishi Mandalam is Dhruvaloka. So Dhruva is away. It is exactly similar to Arsa Major, is similar to that Arsa Minor. But Arsa Minor is a flip horizontal, flip vertical position, is Arsa Minor. So it has also seven stars. But the last one, the tail end star, is called Polaris. This is the most brightest star, can be easily seen in the northern sky by anybody with naked eye on any clear night, all through the year. Similarly, the seven rishis also, the seven stars can be seen throughout the year in the northern sky. And one can find there is also a pole pointer, and this Polaris is actually relied upon navigation in engineering and space technology. So for us also, for viewing Saptarishis and also the Dhruva, Vasistha and Arundhati, besides Dhruva, we have got a pointer we find here. A pointer has come, Polaris pointer. So the line joining Polaha and Polastha Kratu, we find Merak and Dubey combined. The line joining this Arsa Major extended will naturally point to Polaris. So it's the layman's guidance in the northern sky to search for these two planets. The Saptarishis on one side and the Polaris on the other side. Polaris is the brightest one. It is always the tail end of this Arsa Minor. So Arsa Major and Arsa Minor can be easily seen in the northern sky on any clear night. Throughout the year they are visible and they are very bright stars. They can easily identify the tail end star as Polaris. If they find any difficulty, the thing guidance here is the line joining Merak and Dubey extended will naturally point to this. This is called the Big Bear because this one, together with adjoining constellations, will naturally give a bear figure. Similarly, here the small bear. So this is Saptarishi Mandalam, and above it is Dhruva Mandalam. This is the Polaris, the brightest of all the stars, can be easily seen in the northern sky. And regarding Vasistha and Arundhati is concerned, we have seen the two stars in the Saptarishi Mandalam, that is Arsa Major, that is Mizar and Alka. These two are stars, and just above Mizar, we have seen a small star, Alkar. Alkar is Arundhati and Mizar is Vasishtha. These are two binary stars. So binary stars, a mystery yet to be solved in astronomy, is well known to our ancients some ageless times. So these are the two binary stars. A mystery yet to be solved is a mystery in astronomy, because astronomy knows that all the planets revolve around a star, just as our solar system. But we do not know how a star revolves around another star. Anyway, recently astronomy know that one star can revolve around another star, but one star is stationary and another star revolves around it. But this is a complex one, where in the binary stars here in Saptarshi Mandalam, it is not that one star revolves around the other, but both the stars revolve one around the other. Here we can see, it is not one stationary and another revolving, it is each star is revolving around the other. This has got a great significance point of view in conferring the benefit on a newly married wife and husband. So the significance of viewing Arundhati, significance of viewing Vasishtha, and significance of viewing Dhruva as a post-marriage ritual can be very well seen, that Arundhati grants everlasting purity and the chastity to the bride. And Vasishtha grants the groom with the strength to carry on the legacy. Families have got their own legacy, their own formalities and other things. So this will be carried through. So Vasishtha gives the strength to the groom, and Arundhati gives strength of being pure and chastity to the bride. And Arundhati and Vasishtha, as we have seen, binary stars, they are revolving one around the other. That is the affection. That wife and husband will actually go one after the other. It is not as if that one is superior or the other is inferior. We always call Arundhati Vasishtha, but not Vasishtha and Arundhati. That is the importance that we give to females in our culture. We need not be taught by any other religion about how to respect women. So Arundhati and Vasishtha are an ideal couple. The name Arundhati, literally Sanskrit, means Arun is always the sun rays, and Dhati means it is washed. She is such a pure and chaste woman. And they, because these binary stars, Vasishtha and Arundhati and Vasishtha, are revolving around the other, they are also doing things in life in synchronization. And they are the symbol of conjugal love and affection. That is what is required of man and woman in a marriage. Marriage is an institution, but not a contract. Viewing them, newly married couple will be blessed with all these qualities. So the bride and the bridegroom, post-ritual, marriage ritual, viewing these two, Arundhati and Vasishtha, will confer all the qualities of them and shower on them. And significance of viewing Dhruva. Dhruva means it's always stability. The whole celestial sphere is stable because of Dhruva, because he is at the hub at the top. He doesn't revolve, he only rotates, and the entire celestial sphere revolves. Therefore, he is very stable. Around him, everything revolves. So, such a stability is granted to both the bride and the bridegroom in the marriage. And bridegroom shows the bride after the marriage. It is not a Purohit that shows the Dhruva to the bride, but it is the husband that shows the newly married person. He shows his wife, Dhruva, and then utters this. Heaven is stable. There's a mantra for this, and it's very sacred. It has to be recited, and we must have belief in it if at all we want to save our marriages and have a peaceful living and coexistence. So the husband says, heaven is stable, the earth is stable, the universe is stable, these mountains are stable. May this woman be stable in her husband's family. The bridegroom shows the pole star to the bride and prays that the bride is fixed in the home, just like the pole star fixed in the firmament. So this is the essence of that, and we must have belief in it, and also the astronomy and the life side of it, the astrology, should go well in the life of everybody, and we wish that everybody from hereafter will have peace in their families. This, I have shown it here, is the entire 14 universes put together. It is not single universe, it is multiverse, according to our Vishnu Purana. So here it is, the Patala Lokas, Lokas below the Bhumandalam. And these are all the Lokas above the Bhumandalam. And this is the Bhumandalam. And here it is Suri Loka, Mercury, Venus, and all these things at 2 lakh yojanas each distance. The next above that is this Loka, Lakshatra Loka. And above that is Meru. That is the hill, Meru Parvatam. That is at a height. And after that is actually Saptarshi Lokas. We can see this Saptarshi Lokas here. And above it is Dhruva Loka. This is Dhruva Loka. The whole celestial sphere is moving around. He is at the hub. And above Dhruva Loka is Mahar Loka, Jana Loka, Tapa Loka, Satya Loka. That's the point of no return. One who does extraordinarily good things and finally attains liberation, moksha, he goes to Brahma Loka, that is Satya Loka, and he is never reborn unless he wishes to take birth for the prosperity of the world. And above that is Vaikuntha Loka, which is 26,200,000 yojanas away. So to reach that point, it is only our actions that help us to reach that point with no time in the wink of an eye. We need not to go there. We will be fetched to that point unless our actions are good. So during the four seasons of the year, the Asa Major, the Saptarishi's positions change like this. So it moves from here. So you can note down this particular line that is actually going towards the Polaris. And this line is now here. It has shifted to this point. So the tail has come here and it is again pointing to the Polaris. That is shifted, it is pointing to the Polaris. So wherever the Asa Major is, its position may tilt 90 degrees each time. In the four quarters of the season of the year, four seasons, still that can be seen. Because all this particular line, which I have shown as a pointer towards the Polaris, we find the pointers here also. In whichever direction they are, they point always to the Polaris. So it is easy as to see in the northern sky this Asa Major, and also that is Vasishtha, Arundhati Vasishtha couple, and also Polaris Dhruva. So here we are, this is that, this is the equator, the celestial equator, the south pole here and the north pole there, or that. And the same thing extended, the celestial sphere, here it is true north, where Dhruva is placed. So the whole thing actually revolves from this point. So Dhruva doesn't revolve, but he only revolves this complete celestial sphere. Not only this Earth, but all the other planets and all the solar system, the galaxy, the entire universe, and universes for that matter. Here I have put in the celestial, the satellite map about the northern hemisphere for the benefit of the viewers. Where, when, and how to look up for Dhruva, Vasishtha, and Arundhati in the night sky. This is the night sky, this is a satellite picture. I put it here. I will show it. Here I have shown on the side, right hand side, the Asa Major and Asa Minor, which we have seen in the other slide. And the same thing, I am noting it down here. You can see here the Asa Major and Asa Minor here. Asa Minor. They are in the northern sky. This is the north. So this is, these two are joining pointer. Here also we find the pointer coming to it. So that's the polaris. There is another equally like Ursa Minor. There is another equally brightest constellation that is called Cassiopeia. Cassiopeia is something similar to M written, tilted M. Here we have got that. Cassiopeia. This is also a brightest constellation. So this can also be used for pointing towards the polaris, just like Ursa Minor and Ursa Major. Ursa Major, that line extended will naturally point to Ursa Minor, the tail end of the star polaris. Similarly, Cassiopeia can also be used as the brightest constellation for guidance towards polaris. That is the polaris. So the entire celestial pole is actually moving towards north. And here you've got the Cassiopeia, another brightest constellation which I said now. And from there also we find the center of that M, that star, from that center we find it is pointing towards north, this polaris. So polaris can be actually pointed either from the middle star of the constellation Cassiopeia or from the Ursa Major to Ursa Minor and then to Polaris. So this is how it is. I have enlarged that. So from Ursa Major, the line extending to Polaris of Ursa Minor, the last tail end star. And similarly, from Cassiopeia also we can find out this. So it is a northeast constellation. This north and east, northeast constellation. And the same thing, I have again magnified it. Half hemisphere I have taken. I have shown this Ursa Major and Ursa Minor. And that is the polaris. And here the line extend, connecting this particular line extended to that points to polaris. And this actually the pole points to this. This is Dhruva and he is seated here. And the other one, Cassiopeia here. From there also we can find it is pointing towards that particular, these two then joined will be a straight line. So why it happens, why polaris changes once in 26,000 years is because of the wobbling of the earth. Because the earth is actually rotating, slowly wobbles. And its wobbling cannot be seen by us because it is only just 50 seconds a year. It is exactly 50 seconds, not 50, about 50.24 or anything as in astronomy. But we have seen the other day, it is exactly absolutely 50 seconds per year. And therefore, we don't see the difference. But it is accumulated since Aries of sidereal zodiac and also the moving zodiac or the tropical zodiac coincided in 285 AD, it has moved nearly 24 degrees ionosphere, and therefore at the rate of 50 seconds per year, it is nearly 3,000 years have passed since the coincidence, and we are still accumulating it. Every year we are adding 50 seconds to our existing ionosphere. So this wobbling cannot be seen. But in the slide, I am showing it. And here it is another interesting geographical feature. We studied geography and history in our school. We did not have social studies at that time. So this is the map of the United States of America. And this is the Alaska state, the extreme end of it, almost near the North Pole, Arctic. The temperature of which one can easily estimate is nearly 6 months, all through the year it is snow, and 6 months night and 6 months day. So one day is there is 1 year for us. Therefore, this Alaska has got the state flag. This state flag is Assam Hija. They see it from there daily, they see it. But they don't know the significance. That's the beauty of it. Those who see it daily do not know the significance. But we know the significance, so we don't see it. So we are now making it that East meets West, and the whole thing is all combined. It's a whole sphere. So this is the state flag, the Ursa Major. And here also the polar is very prominently seen in Ursa Minor. Therefore, they are fortunate to see it daily, almost throughout. Because even daytime also is not much sunshine. And therefore, it is almost night in the horizon. They can see this even in the daytime. So all through the year, these two planets, these two constellations are visible and are fortunate enough indirectly, even without knowing the significance. How fortunate we would be if we were there, knowing the significance. So one can see here the latitude of North Pole is given and the longitude is also given. And Alaska, USA is also given here. One can see there is absolutely no difference between the degrees 64 and 147 and 147. It's only a difference in fraction. So this is all about the end of both parts 5 and 6, the episode of the third episode, and regarding the significance of viewing the Saptarshi Mandalam and Dhruva as a post-marriage ritual, and also prohibiting the marriages from the Sagotra in order to save ourselves from the predicament of having such highly genetically distorted children. At least from the father's side, the distorted genetic identification of the foetus can be easily noted down and the foetus can be terminated. But on the maternal side, it is for 7 generations prohibited. One should take note of it. And in astrology, we have got Jupiter, who always carries the marriage. And we have already limited willingly the 3. I am leaving this servant so that I can. That in astrology, Jupiter signifies the first the marriages and other things are actually noted from the revolution of Jupiter. Satyacharya in his Satyajatakam, a contribution from Dhruvanadi, he says that Jupiter's revolutions will have to be used for fixing the time of marriage. And also that Saturn should be used for fixing the longevity of a person. We have willingly and more scientifically and reasonably, we have omitted considering the outer planets beyond the orbit of Saturn because their orbital periods are very greater than the normal average span of 60 or 70, 80 years of life of a human being, and even 120 years for the other two planets, Neptune and Pluto. So on that basis, one of the reasons we have omitted considering outer planets, and this is one of the reasons that in prediction, Jupiter's and Saturn's revolutions are considered for marriage, estimating the marriage of a person or the longevity of a person. So thus, astrology helps in knowing astronomy, and astronomy and astrology together help to understand philosophy better and have greater confidence driven into us so that we follow the hymns and the mantras that are actually asked to be chanted with sincerity and faith.
So thank you so much, Doctor. It was such a wonderful trip we had. We felt like we were traveling into space and we really saw Arundhati and Vashishta and all the great rishis in the cosmic world. It was an extraordinary journey. Thank you so much. And you made it very simple. You made it very simple. And I'm sure our subscribers are going to have a wonderful time with your video. And I request all of them to ask questions in case they have. And I think maybe in one of the future sessions, you could answer them.
In this connection, I would like to say that we have completed 5 revolutions of Jupiter. So,
Yes.
The child birth to that of adolescent, and adolescent has become a postgraduate, employed, and then married. And the married life continues for three more revolutions of Jupiter successfully and happily. And the sixth and seventh revolutions of Jupiter we will deal in next episode. That is about Shashtabdi Purti and again Shatabhishekam, wherein astrology comes in more relatively and importantly along with astronomy and philosophy.
Superb, sir.
Thank you,
so,
sir.
Thank you so much, and we'll meet you again once again next week.
Yes, sir. Very kind of you.